Now meet the team responsible for 10 years of The Simpsons in America's First Family.
Oh, Marge, cartoons don't have any deep meaning. They're just stupid drawings that give you a cheap laugh.
The Simpsons is a surprisingly big phenomenon. I mean, nobody's more surprised than the people working on it.
So, any words for the bride and groom?
Not now, Bart. I'm trying to urinate.
Oh, yeah. I think anytime something like this strikes such a chord or does so well, it's a lot of pieces coming together.
Who's the Bart man?
This is the longest I've ever done anything, including school.
I had no clue, no sense that, you know, 10 years later I'd be sitting here doing this interview with you, celebrating this anniversary.
Who's the Bart man?
I cannot believe The Simpsons has been on the air for 10 years. It's staggering.
Perfecto! Everybody smile. I'm going to set the automatic timer.
The Simpsons may have conquered the world, but they started life as just a tiny gleam in the mind of one offbeat comic strip artist, Matt Groening. The mischievous, yellow-skinned, spiky-haired Bart first drew breath back in 1986. Before The Simpsons walked the earth, Matt's only other taste of success had been as the creator of an underground comic strip, Life in Hell. But he always knew that one day, television would come calling.
I was waiting, when is Hollywood gonna call me up? Come on, I'm doing this weekly comic strip, and finally, ring, 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 it's James L. Brooks, who loves my strip Life in Hell, and he gives me my first job on the Tracy Ullman Show, doing animation. And he said, you can do whatever you want.
James L. Brooks is one of Hollywood's most original television producers, the brains behind series like Taxi and Rhoda. While creating a show around British comedian Tracy Ullman, he decided to commission some short cartoons to place before and after commercial breaks.
We were looking for, we call them bumpers, which go between the acts, and we decided nobody ever tried to make them entertaining, so we tried to make them entertaining. And I had a cartoon that I'd gotten as a gift from somebody that was Matt's cartoon, The Los Angeles Way of Death, the way that people die in Los Angeles, California. And I had remembered this because it was my first exposure to Matt, so we called him in.
Well, The Simpsons really began in the 15 minutes that I had to prepare for a meeting with Jim Brooks to present him with my ideas. I was originally going to do my Life in Hell characters in animated form, and then at the last moment I got scared. I thought, what if this fails miserably? I'll have ruined my characters, I'll go crawling back to my weekly comic strip. So I decided to make up new characters on the spot, hence The Simpsons, named after my own family. I wasn't particularly feeling creative that in that 15 minutes, so I quickly named them after my own family. I do have a father named Homer, a mother named Margaret. Marge is close. I thought Marge was a slightly funnier name, and I have two younger sisters, Lisa and Maggie. I thought if I made the main kid Matt, that would be a little too obvious, so I changed him to Bart.
And we just did it in a very loose way, at these little 30-second spots.
Oh, yeah?
How many times do I have to tell you kids? I absolutely forbid burping in this household.
How's it going, everybody? Oops, pardon my French.
What they needed now were voices. Luckily, they didn't have far to look for Homer and Marge.
Dan Castellaneta and myself were there anyway, doing the Tracy Show. So they asked us to be the parents, and they hired Nancy Cartwright and Yardley Smith to play the kids. And on the Tracy Show, whatever you're handed, you do.
Get in there!
And clean up that mess!
I had done voiceover for radio and television stuff in Chicago, so I had a background doing that, so I guess I think even Tracy had sort of seen it on my resume. She said, oh, you do voiceover. So they just used me for that. So there was, I didn't have to audition. I had the part going in.
Where are you, boy?
Oops.
Aha!
I was seen in a play by the casting director, Bonnie Pietola, and I was playing a juvenile delinquent who sang Elvis songs. So how you get from that to Lisa Simpson, I don't know, but that woman has a gift, I'll say. She remembered I had a funny voice, so she brought me in actually to read for Bart. But that was a disaster right from the go, because I just sound way too much like a girl all the time.
I'll be Lisui, the Devil May Care rocket pilot. And you'll be... Artron, the evil robot from Mars gone berserk.
I remember going in and sitting in this green room and sitting on the couch and seeing you. I picked up the sides for Lisa and I saw the audition piece and I saw her face and I tried to get, you know, a clue of who she was. And it didn't, it was okay, but it didn't really enough to say, oh, wow, I really got to have this. But the picture of Bart was sitting in there and the sides for him. So I picked that up and looked at it. And, I mean, this guy, because he's 10 years old, he argues.
Who cares? Oh, shut up. You shut up.
He beats his sister up. He gets choked.
Are you ready?
He's a troublemaker.
One, Maggie. Take a cookie.
He's antagonistic.
I'm Bart Simpson. Who the hell are you?
I mean, this guy's like, you know, it's juicy stuff for an actor to, like, sink their teeth into. I thought, yeah, I want to do him. They, like, put me on a little cassette recorder. And then, so I read for Bart's, and then, you want to read for Lisa? Okay, so I read for that. Well, all right, that's pretty good. And then, like, a couple of days later, okay, well, let's do that. But you got the part, and you're like, really? And I didn't even know what I was doing.
This is a dorky show, Bart. Change the channel.
No.
Change the channel.
No.
Change the channel.
No.
Change the channel.
No.
Hey, turn that back on!
Everybody says, how'd you come up with the voice? Well, I didn't have that many options, so I just went up, because she's 8.
I channeled a 10-year-old yellow-skinned, spiky-headed boy. No, it was mine. It was totally mine.
I Columba.
Bart.
Whoa, Mama.
Bart.
Wow. Now that's what I call the enriching world of art.
Not bad.
I'm Bart Simpson. Who the hell are you?
He's the number one guy.
My voice was very tired, as it is now. And I said, well, what about this? I just kind of exaggerated the tiredness. And he said, fine.
Oh, look at that. Our own two husky men snuggled together on the couch.
The drawing of Homer looks different as it does now. Before, he was very floppy, and he had a very big overbite, and he was kind of very deadpan.
So I sort of started with a Walter Matthau. Kind of a voice like that.
Well, here we are, the whole family, snuggling up, bonding together as only a tightly knit family can. Why, we're more than
Dad, you can stop now. Commercial's over and the show's back on.
Oh, and it was just hard to sustain that.
It just took a lot of energy. And also the emotions are all over.
And so it moved down from the, I don't know, adenoids or whatever, and went down into the throat. It kept dropping down into the throat, and it just sounded a little more dopier, but it more comfortable, because I could be really sad, and then, oh no, there's no more donuts. Ooh, there's one under the couch.
Catch this one, and we all get chocolate milkshakes.
If you want to know why the early Simpsons on the Tracy Ullman Show look so weird, it's because I didn't know what I was doing. I just would draw little sketches to give to the animators. I thought they were going to clean them up and make them look like professional cartoons. It turns out that all they were doing was tracing my drawings.
They may not have looked like any other cartoon, but the Simpsons proved so popular that Fox took a leap into the void and gave Matt his very own full-length show.
That boy just don't listen.
To air The Simpsons, Fox had to commit $10 million to produce 13 episodes before they saw a single one. And then again, it was people producing it who had never done a show, an animated show, half an hour long. All that had been done was the shorts.
Fox finally, you know, got the idea that this would make a good series, but they were a little hesitant at first because primetime animation was something that hadn't been seen on American television for about a generation.
When I got my job in The Simpsons, my partner and I joined because no one else we knew wanted the job. It was almost a dead end in terms of animation. It was just totally dead on primetime. Nothing had succeeded since The Flintstones 20 years earlier. And what encouraged me about the show was that it was James Brooks and Sam Simon, Matt Groening were really talented. The stories that they are already working out seemed hilarious, and the characters were great. The shorts were really funny. So I thought, you know, if this gets on the air, I think it actually could turn a few heads.
Good one, Dad.
Okay, kids, prepare to be dazzled. Marge, turn on the juice!
And so by Christmas 1989, the first ever episode of The Simpsons was broadcast. And it turned more than a few heads.
Hey, Simpson!
What is it, Flanders?
Oh, do you think this looks okay?
Oh, neato.
It's too bright.
Here was something that was smart and funny and hip and original and reminded us that something that's really family entertainment will appeal to the least sophisticated member of the audience and the most sophisticated member of the audience on different levels.
This was just what the upstart Fox network needed, a completely unexpected hit. It put them on the map, as well as creating a bonanza for the spin-off industry.
One of the most delightful aspects of Simpsons mania in the early 1990s was how many different groups appropriated Bart Simpson. There were black Bart t-shirts. There was a t-shirt with Bart shaking hands with Nelson Mandela. There were Irish Bart t-shirts. There were Mexican Bart t-shirts. There were vegetarian Bart t-shirts that said, "Don't eat a cow, man." There were pro-Gulf War t-shirts with Bart standing on Saddam Hussein's head. There were anti-war t-shirts with Bart protesting the war. It was amazing how many people could take this cute little guy and make him their own.
He said, "Whoa, mama."
There was no stopping Fox now. They went for broke by scheduling The Simpsons right opposite America's then number one hit, The Cosby Show. Two TV families slugged it out, one aspirational and upwardly mobile, the other not.
Lord, before we peel the foil back from your bounty, we ask you to watch over...
And it was the downwardly mobile Simpsons that finally won.
It held its own. It did really well. You know, it ended that season in the top 10, you know, so I think that's quite an impressive feat. And that was a big message, you know, it caused a little stir. The contrast was so severe, just seeing on literally, you flip the channel to NBC, you see happy Cosby family, and then just pure bedlam on Fox with The Simpsons.
Rod, Todd, this is God.
How did you get on the radio?
By the end of the first series, the world had a new star, Bart.
Stupid kid.
Forgive my brother. Will you believe you?
Talk is cheap. Perhaps a test of thy faith. Walk through the wall. I will remove it for you. Later. Jingle bells, jingle bells.
Bart! Why are you doing that?
I don't know. Stick around, Mr. Bond. Things are really starting to cook.
Bart may have underachieved for America, but his attitude and his catchphrases made him irresistible.
Don't have a cow, Dad. Get bent. Hi, caramba! Eat my shorts.
Hey, give me some of that.
But The Simpsons was never a cartoon meant just for kids. While children of all ages latched onto Bart, everybody else had the grown-ups to identify with.
It's coming out!
Bart was always the publicity focus of the show. But in my heart, I always knew that Homer was the man. Because Homer, first of all, there were more consequences when Homer did bad things. I mean, he was going to cause a meltdown and maybe ruin, you know, all of Springfield.
Okay, don't panic. Whatever problem this is, I'm sure they know how to handle it. Huh? Ah! It's my problem! We're doomed!
Sector 7G is now being isolated.
Look at this. Look at this character. Look at, he's got the donut, he's got the cake, he's got more cake, he's happy. He is admitting what we all crave.
Caramels, waffle batter, liquid smoke.
Ooh, waffle runoff.
He enjoys the things that we all wish we could enjoy, except we feel guilty about.
Fattening.
You couldn't have Homer without Marge. And Marge has the thankless role on the show. She's the one who says, you know, "I don't think that's a good idea, Homie," or, you know, things like that. But without somebody pulling Homer in once in a while or giving him a reason to care, the show wouldn't work.
Of all the terrible things you've ever done in your life, this is the worst, the most despicable.
But Marge, I swear to you, I never thought you'd find out.
She's the anchor of the family. I think she's the one that holds everything together because it is so fragile, as a lot of families are.
There you go, Lisa. No pimentos. Bart, your hat's where you left it, behind the toilet. Homer, I'll sew your pants, but I'm out of bologna.
Thanks, Mom.
Thanks, Mom.
Don't!
In contrast to the rest of her family, Lisa was the only Simpson to be burdened with intelligence and sensitivity.
A lot of people really identify with Lisa on the show as kind of the moral center of the show.
I'm telling you, Flanders' store was deserted.
Dad, do you know what schadenfreude is?
No, I do not know what schadenfreude is. Please tell me because I'm dying to know.
It's a German term for shameful joy. Taking pleasure in the suffering of others.
Oh, come on, Lisa. I'm just glad to see him fall flat on his butt.
She's a genius. She's a prodigy. She takes a stand on any number of issues, but she's eight. And I think as soon as you lose the childlike charm of her, then she becomes insufferable.
I'm just wondering, what's the point? Would it make any difference at all if I never existed? How can we sleep at night when there's so much suffering in the world?
Really? Come on, Lisa, ride the Homer horsey. Giddy up, whee!
Along with the dummy-sucking baby escapee, Maggie, the Simpsons inhabit Springfield, a living, breathing, all-American town. A place rich in spiritual life.
My friends, the devil walks among us.
I got him!
A town for all generations.
Well, well. If it isn't the Tooth Fairy.
With vigilant local cops.
Oh, isn't that cute? A baby driving a car. And look, there's a dog driving a bus.
And impregnable jails.
All right, time for a crime spree.
Harboring a love that dare not speak its name.
I love you, Smithers.
Feeling is more than neutral, sir.
Where the young are hungry for knowledge.
Wait a minute! You didn't learn how World War II ended. We won!
The local media are fearless.
Tonight on Eye on Springfield, we meet a man who's been hiccuping for 45 years.
Kill me. Kill me.
The economic slump began last spring when the government closed Fort Springfield, devastating the city's liquor and prostitution industries.
A town bursting with high culture.
Will there be beer?
Friendly neighborhood grocers.
Ooh,
dead.
This is not a library.
A library.
This is not a quickie mart.
Fast food.
Oh.
A city that never sleeps.
Sometimes you gotta go where everybody knows your name. Hey, guys!
In short, a whole universe and a cast of thousands.
I think one of the secret weapons of the show are all the secondary characters. Apu, Mo and Mo's bar, Barney the barfly, Principal Skinner, Principal Skinner's mom.
The growth of the show has been partly due just to the richness of the universe, the fact that, you know, when you're watching Frasier and it's a great show, you still think it's going to be some permutation of those basic characters that they have, where with our show you have no idea what you're going to get every week.
All voiced by the same inner core of actors who play the principal characters.
The first voice I ever did was Mo the bartender, and I was doing kind of a bad Pacino impression. I was kind of talking like this, what I like this. And I did that voice for Mo, and Matt Groening actually said, we see it as more gravelly, so I just made it like this.
When I get a hold of you, I'm going to use your head for a bucket and paint my house with your brain.
I do Krusty the Clown.
Hey, kids. When I came on, they said I wouldn't last a week. And you know where those reviewers are? All dead.
These hot dogs have been here for 3 years. They are strictly ornamental.
I don't know why that voice is so funny. It's so, it's kind of lilting, and it just, for some reason, it's talking this way is very pleasing to people. I don't know why it is.
There is only one bozo who comes in and buys them.
But I... Oh.
My personal favorite is Ralph Wiggum.
My cat's breath smells like cat food. I've been here 2 hours, and Bart still hasn't finded me.
And I do a Grandpa Simpson.
In my day, we didn't have any. We didn't have anything. Bart, is that light green?
Yeah.
It better be.
Hey, Wiggum, come
Now, please, I can assure you we'll be using the most advanced scientific techniques in the field of body finding.
Wiggum, I always has to come out of the side of my mouth. I don't know why.
Why don't you come on over to my house and put your hands on the gun? Never hurts to get a second set of prints.
It's Nelson Munns.
That's my dad's shooting car. Just three more payments and it's ours.
Hey, what's this?
A sneeze guard.
Wow, it really works.
Barney Gumble.
Hey, Homer, could you lend me $5 for a beer?
Lou the cop kind of sounds like Stallone.
And Cinderella had the most beautiful gown at the ball, with 8 satin petticoats, each more delicate than the last.
Mayor Quimby, not to be confused with anybody whose last name is Kennedy.
I propose that I use what's left of the town treasury to move to a more prosperous town and run for mayor. And once elected, I will send for the rest of you.
There's Todd Flanders, or Rod. I'm not sure if I'm Todd or Rod.
I've got the joy down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart, Tuesday.
I get to anoint his feet.
Groundskeeper Willie, I'm not cleaning up that mess. No, sir.
Will you get a hold of yourself, lass, for the wee parents?
I enjoy doing Professor Frink, because I'm a big Jerry Lewis fan, and I just, for some reason, I could talk like this all day.
Nice try, Floyd, but you were designed for scrubbing, and scrubbing is what you shall do.
Springfield may be another all-American Pleasantville, but its magnetic pull is strong, and Hot cannot resist.
Hello, can I help you?
Agents Mulder and Scully, FBI.
We've had a mix of celebrities on the show. Sometimes they play themselves.
Leonard Nimoy, what are you doing here?
Wherever there is mystery and the unexplained, cosmic forces shall draw me near.
Mm-hmm.
Miss Taylor, a couple of grade school kids wanted you to be on a Krusty special. I told them to puzzle off.
Good.
Wow, Paul McCartney. I read about you in history class.
Usually, they prefer to play a character, I think, or to play themselves in a different way than people know them.
My partner and I did write a show starring Michael Jackson that we liked, where Lisa was having a bad birthday and he wrote a song for the show to give her as a present. That was really neat.
Lisa, it's your birthday. God bless you this day. You gave me the gift of a little sister and I'm proud of you today.
Michael Jackson was a big fan of the show, and I just thought it was so brilliant to have Michael Jackson portrayed as a big, insane white guy who thought he was Michael Jackson. I think that was one of the most brilliant uses of a celebrity.
Wow! How do you do that thing with your feet?
The moonwalk?
No, that thing with your feet!
Here, look, just raise your heel a bit and put a little pressure on the ball of your foot.
Like The Muppets some years ago, it's a show that a lot of actors want to do because it's something they can share with their kids, and it's something very hip and funny.
I'm a Simpsons fan, and I was flattered when they asked me to do it.
Tom Jones?
Yes?
I was wondering if you'd be interested in performing at a private party.
Sorry, mate, I don't do private parties. I like my drawing, yes. I thought it was good because, you know, when somebody's going to make a cartoon out of you, you don't know what it's going to look like. It was fine. It did a good job. I mean, it looked like me. I mean, it was a cartoon of me, but I think you could tell who it was.
Get help, love. Call Interpol. Get me a hacksaw. Anything.
Everybody in my house laughed like hell.
It happens every day, no matter what you say.
They've had all 3 surviving Beatles. They've had Elizabeth Taylor. They've had Mel Gibson. You know, an array of voices that ordinarily no television show would think of approaching or could afford.
I got it! Homer, are you okay?
I think so. No.
I went to one of those test screenings one night. I was bursting. I hadn't been to the men's room. I was like, oh, gee, I'm just going to sneak out the back door and take a leak behind the dumpster, I said. So that actually somebody told them that I did that once, so they put it into the episode. Listen, I don't want to get spotted by the crowd, so I'm going to take a leak behind the dumpster.
Look, it's Mel Gibson. Hey, everybody, rush over there.
Well, all the guest stars we have on the show read what they're going to do ahead of time. So anytime someone says, look, I wouldn't want to do this particular thing, we don't make them do it.
Barney, you've been riding my back all night.
Oh, yeah? Can I step outside?
Let's do it.
One change we had to make, for example, is we had a Joe Frazier on the show, and The scene we wrote had him losing a fight to Barney, and he said, Joe Frazier doesn't lose to Barney. So we had him win the fight, and he agreed to do the show.
All right, a peanut!
The creators of the show worked to one basic rule. The Simpsons is never a mere cartoon.
I think there's a counterculture sensitivity to the show that Matt added right from the beginning that we were all trying to emulate. And I think what Jim Brooks added was this real warmth and humanness to the characters that you can see in his work, like the Mary Tyler Moore show. And, you know, put together, those two elements really made something that was unusual in TV for its time.
The whole idea was to take animation and make it adhere to the same rules we followed, you know, in a live-action series. To care about our characters, to care about their history, to care about our story.
It was very important to establish to the audience that this was a real family and that you could actually be emotionally moved by the show, which did happen in a surprising way.
Goodbye, John.
Wait, Dad! Don't do it!
And they achieve this by making sure that what they do is less cartoonish than the usual TV animation.
Oh, I love you, Dad.
I love you too, John. You know, boy, I don't think I've ever felt as close to you as I do right now.
We have what I call rubber band reality. We have our rules that the characters obey. They don't get to walk off cliffs and walk on the air until they realize that they're walking in, and then they fall to their doom the way they do in, say, Roadrunner cartoons. Our characters skateboard off cliffs, and they think they're going to make it all the way across.
I'm going to make it. I'm going to make it.
There's some aerodynamic principle at work.
Woohoo! Woohoo!
Then they fall. And when they hit the side of the cliff on the way down, they feel pain. And they feel it in a way that you don't usually get in cartoons. When we're putting together the sound effects, we don't have boings and bleeps and womps and all crazy sound effects. We have as realistic sound effects as we can get. For some reason, it's funnier.
Only then can they really let their imaginations rip.
One of the great things about having an animated sitcom, unlike a live-action show, we can draw anything we want to.
We understand, Homer. After all, we are from the land of chocolate.
The land of chocolate.
We can do any fantasy, flashback, flash-forward, hallucination. We can actually show the shows that the family is watching. On a regular sitcom, you can't do that. You just have the family looking at an off-screen TV and you have some sounds. But we can actually show Itchy and Scratchy and all the rest of that stuff. It's great.
Oh, I heard about this. This is the one where Scratchy finally gets Itchy. Wow!
But in one sense, the world of The Simpsons is all too real. Springfield's top-rated show is, of course, a cartoon, the ultra-violent Itchy and Scratchy.
The irony of it is not lost on people my age who are familiar with Tom and Jerry. I do worry sometimes that kids who have no idea what the reference is, that they accept it just at face value.
I don't think that Itchy and Scratchy would have gotten on the air in undiluted format. And the fact is, you only see a few seconds of Itchy and Scratchy.
My purpose in life is to witness this moment.
I can't tell you the number of fan letters we get from people who think that Itchy and Scratchy should have their own show, and I don't think they really want what they're asking for.
The TV! The TV!
They'll never let us show that again. Not in a million years.
A lot of the humor in the show comes from having writers who are smart, very aware, and very sort of tuned in to what's going on around them, who pick up on catchphrases and fads.
Budweiser. Coors.
And who also have a good knowledge of not only animation history, but film history, so that they can spoof various genres and even individual films.
Ooh.
We have a place for babies like you. The box!
An advantage of being such a long-running series is the chance it offers to repeat and build on favorite gags.
Is Al there?
Al?
Yeah, Al. Last name, Caholic?
Let me check. Phone call for Al. Alcoholic.
Jock Strap. Is I.P. Freely here? Hey, is there a butts here? Seymour Butts. Homosexual. My crotch.
Amanda Hug and Kiss. That's a good one. I need Amanda Hug and Kiss.
Amanda Hug and Kiss.
Huge ass.
Ivana Tinkle.
I'm a stupid moron with an ugly face and a big butt, and my butt smells, and I like to kiss my own butt.
There's also a much more sophisticated level of humor that's being played, much of it verbal, that's satirizing politicians and the fads and foibles of society and of show business. And that'll makes it a very appealing package.
Hey, how come the Smithsonian needs to be sponsored by a cell phone company?
I can answer that. Uncle Sam needs to spend our tax dollars on the essentials. Anti-tobacco programs, pro-tobacco programs, killing wild donkeys, and Israel.
Good old government.
I think that the basic rule for any Simpsons writer is, first and foremost, you have to have a healthy disrespect for everything Americans hold dear.
America's greatest citizen summed up in one piece of clothing.
Fonzie's jacket!
I think the show is also about questioning authority and not accepting things at face value, showing the other side of things.
Apu, I see you're not in church.
Oh, but I am. I have a shrine to Ganesha, the god of worldly wisdom, located in the employee lounge.
Hey, Ganesha, want a peanut?
Please do not offer my god a peanut.
No offense, Apu, but when they were handing out religions, you must have been out taking a whiz.
For me, what's great about The Simpsons is that we have no sacred cows. We can make fun of anyone we want, any religion we want, any group. And it's fun to make fun of people in power.
I know you don't think you're good enough for me, but believe me, you are. Hell, I've done it with pigs. Real no-fooling pigs.
Are you sure it's a federal law that I have to dance with you?
The show is set up in a unique way. When James L. Brooks and Matt Groening first set the show up with Fox, it was set up in a way where the studio and the network would not be involved in the creative process. Normally, they would be allowed to come to each script reading and give notes, and you would have to get every story approved. And without that in the way, we're pretty much free to do whatever we want.
This Friday, we're going back to the woods and we're going to find that alien.
What if we don't?
We'll fake it and sell it to the Fox Network.
They'll buy anything.
Now, son, they do a lot of quality programming, too.
If there's any kind of overall message I think we have with The Simpsons, it's not a specific progressive political message, but it's an overall very important message. Your leaders don't always have your best interests in mind. Your teachers, your religious leaders, your political leaders, your spiritual leaders, they may be flawed.
Why the crap we have to go to church anyway?
You just answered your own question with that commode, Mouth. Besides, you kids need to learn morals and decency and how to love your fellow man.
And with flaming swords, the Aramites did pierce the eyes of their fellow men and did feast on what flowed forth.
One of the great things about having a fad that was as intense as The Simpsons is that there are these people that take the bait, and they get upset, and then they criticize the show, and that makes it more exciting. I mean, it's just a TV show. It's a cute little cartoon.
Cartoons don't have messages, Lisa. They're just a bunch of hilarious stuff, you know, like people getting hurt and stuff like that.
George Bush, I think at the Republican convention in 92, said that he wanted America to consist of families that were more like the Waltons than the Simpsons.
We are going to keep on trying to strengthen the American family, to make American families a lot more like the Waltons and a lot less like the Simpsons.
Huh?
So we had Bart say,
we're just like the Waltons. We're praying for an end to the Depression, too.
One of the most delightful things about doing The Simpsons is that we answer all these conservative critics about television. They want families who go to church. The Simpsons go to church. They want families who pray. The Simpsons pray. They want families who have God in their lives. Not only do the Simpsons have God in their lives, we actually show God. And yet they're not thankful.
God?
Thou hast forsaken my church.
Well, kind of, but...
But what?
I'm not a bad guy. I work hard and I love my kids. So why should I spend half my Sunday hearing about how I'm going to hell?
You've got a point there.
We also show the devil. We show hell as a literal flaming place, and Bart has gone there several times in the course of the series. What more do these people want?
Say, is there anything I can do to avoid coming back here?
Oh, sure, yeah, but, you wouldn't like it.
Oh, okay. See you later, then.
Goodbye, Bart. Remember, lie, cheat, steal, and listen to heavy metal music!
Yes, sir!
There's a lot of heart in The Simpsons. The family genuinely loves each other. They really care about what each other thinks, and they stick together.
He's awake!
Oh, Bart! We thought for a minute you'd gone away from us!
And I think that point has been lost on a lot of the critics of the show who kind of blamed The Simpsons for being a dysfunctional family, and I think they were forgetting the part that they were still a family. While a lot of other families don't survive marriages, The Simpsons do.
With an imaginary world as rich and as varied as this, it's no surprise that the making of The Simpsons is a complicated process. It all begins with a large team of writers poring over every last line of script.
Most of the writers are failed pre-meds or people who initially weren't setting out to be sitcom writers. A lot of them came from Variety, like The Letterman Show, and it helped, especially in the beginning, that it wasn't something that was just trying to do the same old jokes in the same old way. It was a staff that was sharp and really approached TV with a sort of aggressive guerrilla attitude.
It might be funny when the bus is peeling out to have the band guy go, "We gotta ride!"
The team do up to 8 rewrites before they consider it ready to be performed.
This is a little more rustic than I expected.
Before a single drawing is begun, the actors come together to record the voices.
The Krusty Brand Seal of Approval. You can only find it on products which meet the high personal standards of Krusty the Clown.
This looks... Ow!
Oh, dear, I should have warned you about that. That clock gets incredibly hot if you leave it plugged in.
Oh, that's okay. You got any Krusty Brand ointment?
And for the matter of my honorarium, my emolument, pay me.
Only now can the animators begin blocking out the scenes.
I could have gotten Rick D's for that.
What we start with is the script, wherein lies the dialogue and all the description of the action. And the dialogue is recorded by the actors onto a voice track. And that's sent over to us, and we make a storyboard. And we see Homer working on his car. And then we cut to him.
A man innocently changes his oil when a two-ton car...
Pan over to Bart, who's videotaping Homer. And then we cut in close.
Crashing down.
The storyboarding phase is probably the most important phase for the animation, because you're going to decide how things look. You're going to decide how jokes are staged and how reveals are revealed to the audience.
Meanwhile, a team of designers create new characters, props, and locations.
We probably have up to 15,000 characters designed at this point, and also 15,000 props and probably 20,000 backgrounds. So it's like we've designed a whole world.
And nobody is allowed to stray from Matt's rules for drawing The Simpsons.
All cartoons have their own little rules. On The Simpsons, our rules are, when we draw eyeballs, eyeballs are always looking in the same direction, or if we want to indicate sort of some sort of angst or alienation, they go wall-eyed. They do not, on The Simpsons, ever do this. We don't have that goofy, "Ooh, I'm goofy and crazy." Or we don't ever do this. We don't do the cross-eyed look either. It's just part of the rule.
One thing that Mac Groening always stressed from the beginning was to be observational, where when we're creating Springfield, it kind of has elements that everyone can relate to. The Quickie Mart, Moe's Bar, the Krusty Burger, which was kind of based on a McDonald's, which everyone knows. Even the Springfield Town Hall was a combination between a town hall in my hometown in New England and Thomas Jefferson's Monticello in Virginia.
So, here we go. Here's the scene translated from the storyboard into the animation. We have the background is at the size it's going to be painted at. We have Bart videotaping Homer. We have Homer on the dolly working on the car. We have the oil filter, and we have to animate the oil filter. We need to know what that looks like. And then we have Homer's hand tightening the oil filter, and we have two drawings here to show how it's going to move.
Once the layout drawings are complete, the outlines are shot under a camera and linked up to the voice track to produce what is called an animatic. This allows the creative team to see the show in rough and make changes before the real animation begins.
Changes, time to change the oil. Changes!
A man innocently changes his oil when a two-ton car comes crashing down. Crashing down! Who'd have thought you could hold up a car with a wicker basket?
I'm here live in Korea to give you a first-hand look at how American cartoons are made.
Like many American television cartoons, The Simpsons' final artwork is done in Korea, where the laborious process of hand-finishing is much more economical. Here, each individual frame is inked and painted by a team of artists, using copious amounts of yellow paint.
To create a single episode of The Simpsons, I would say there's probably 20 to 30,000 drawings in each episode, depending on the difficulty of the episode. So we can have as many as 400 people working on it just to get that episode to air.
The painted cells are filmed, and the now moving images sent back to the U.S. The creative team then get their first sneak preview of the show.
Shut up, Becky! There, I finally said it!
Now all that remains to be added is the music, another huge production number. A 35-piece orchestra performs a specially composed soundtrack.
My approach has always been to score the emotion first. And that's very, very different from the bulk of animated television series that you'll see today, where, you know, if somebody pops somebody in the face with an elbow or pops them in the nose or winks or something like that, every one of those little things are usually caught with the Mickey Mousing approach of scoring, you know, ping, ping, ba-da-da, eh, you know, one of those things. But we don't do that. We always score the emotion first. And I think that is what made the musical intertwining in the episode so successful.
All this fish represents is just how selfish you are.
Well, if that's the way you feel, I'll throw it back.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Watch!
Whoa. I did it. I gave up fame and breakfast for my marriage. I fought it for 6 hours. She says one word and I toss it back.
And you're telling me our marriage is in trouble? Come here, baby.
Oh, Homer.
It's kind of an interesting existence in that if the audience doesn't notice the underscore music consciously, then we've done our job successfully.
One, two, three, four, five, six.
The result is a show with near global appeal.
Very good.
The Simpsons is broadcast in over 100 countries worldwide.
Minna,
I'm pretty baffled by the fact that The Simpsons is so popular all over the world. When it works in Japanese or whatever other language, I'm glad, but I can't explain it.
There's a
cherche, monsieur Homer Simpson.
Mais ça tombe bien, j'ai deux mots à te dire.
Mais lui, enfin.
Marthe, arrête.
Et toi, pas va se faire botter le cul par Mel Gibson. Fais-lui une grosse tête, Homer.
The Simpsons may be an all-American family obsessed with TV, beer and donuts, but the show's humor thrives even when translated into over 30 different languages.
C'est une bague qui prouve qu'elle est ma propriété, qu'elle est à moi.
First of all, you can loop the dialogue, so you can have people in whatever native tongue is spoken hired to play the characters and be really funny, and it doesn't look grafted on.
Mel Gibson n'a besoin de moi. Mel Gibson.
I think that the physical humor that animation provides is universal. I think it plays everywhere. And I think that just the subject matter, the fact that it's this family who has all these typical foibles, is something that is pretty much universal.
Aber bitte bleib doch sitzen, Schatz. Heute werden die Männer den Tisch abräumen. Lebt wohl, Hühnerbeinchen.
Jawohl, Fatze helle Rosenkohl.
Götterspeise wollen wir nicht.
Dann gute Reise, feines Porzellan.
Bart!
I think there's a two-part double whammy message in The Simpsons. One is that you can see yourself in the show, and the other thing is you can look at the Homer Simpson and you go, well, at least I'm not as bad as him. So it's a simultaneous identification with the characters and a feeling of superiority. It's like, as bad as you have it, you don't have it as bad as Homer.
The success of The Simpsons has sparked a run of other animations designed for adult audiences.
Wow, poor Kenny. Now do you believe us, Cartman?
No.
Cartman, they killed Kenny.
He's not dead.
Dude, Kenny is dead. See?
Shut up, you guys. He's dead, Cartman.
As the years went on, Beavis and Butthead came and South Park came, and suddenly we were Ozzie and Harriet, and now we're the show that American families sit down together and watch the show.
I think we're part of the culture now. We're not counterculture. I mean, we're part of the culture. You sit down, you want to have a conversation waiting for an airplane someplace. You talk about The Simpsons, somebody's going to talk to you.
I don't want, you know, Bart Simpson graffiti on my tombstone, you know. I want some other graffiti, you know. So that's why I do Futurama and some of the other stuff that I've been working on.
JFK Jr. Airport.
Cool. Crosstown Express?
I wanted to do another animated TV show just to see if I could do it again, just see if I could pull it off and learn from what I had learned on The Simpsons. And I thought it'd be really fun to take a fantasy genre like science fiction and just go to town with it.
With Matt busy working on Futurama and plans for a Simpsons feature film being considered, what life is there left in a series 10 years old?
Tourist.
Right now we're talking about, in addition to season 12, which is upcoming, doing maybe 13 and 14. And with the richness of the universe, as long as the actors were interested in doing it, I think there'd always be writers who would want to work on it and be motivated to do their best. And there are so many characters, it could go on for a number of years.
Oh dear, I should have warned you about that. That clock gets incredibly hot if you leave it plugged in.
Certainly I'd be happy to do it for as long as it goes on. As long as it's good. I think everybody feels like, why not keep doing it as long as the quality remains high?
Now the effort of writing has made me lightheaded. So I close by saying, save us now!
They're brilliant. They do great things, and it's really, it's the best ticket in town, I think.
Just remember, you're getting paid by the note, right? By the note that's in place. You're gonna be finished.
I love doing it. I love the group of people. I love the writing. So as an actor, it's great.
Why do I always think of the perfect thing to say when it's too late? Shut up, Becky.
I can take doing this show as long as they want to dish it out.
I want to get together sometime with Paul McCartney and say, was it hard after the Beatles? You know, The Simpsons has been such an amazing phenomenon that I know I'll never top it. It's we were in the right place at the right time with the right group of people, and it's a fantastic, fun, wonderful experience that hasn't ended yet.
Marge, I'm confused. Is this a happy ending or a sad ending?
It's an ending. That's enough.
Okay. When I first drew Bart Simpson, I almost always drew him kind of angry. And I think I gave him a lot of spikes. His hair, and they're bigger. But that's the way he originally started out. And now, The problem is, I can draw him, and it's me trying to imitate the professional look of the anime actions, but I can't really draw them correctly. I mean, if I were applying for a job to animate The Simpsons today,
I would not be hired.